Father, we just appreciate your love. We know that we can do nothing. And I pray that we know. I pray that we know. Lord, if this is man, if we're building this, if I'm building this, then let it come to nothing. Lord, let it be scattered to the wind. Because, Lord, these people do not have the time to waste. But, Father, if this is your foundation, then raise it up for many generations. Lord, let us lay this foundation, hold this foundation, and tomorrow, and the next day, and the next day, and 5 years from now, and 10 years from now, if you should so tarry, and 20, until we last breathe our last breath on this earth, that we keep going further into Christ, allowing His perfection through His Word and through the power of His Holy Ghost, and through every inroad that He's provided by the soundness of Your Word. I pray that these things will be manifest both in myself and to those who are hearing us. Tonight, we give You all the praise and all the glory in the precious name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank You, Jesus. Well, we have been looking at the subject of, I said, the boring subject of its maps, the boring message. And this is the fourth of, I think it is. A few weeks ago, I gave you some maps. You probably don't have those. But that's okay, because we're not really going to look at those necessarily. Oh, good students. Wonderful. The teacher in the house has her map. And yes, Candy has hers in, she's got her in a folder. And Ralph, oh my God, and Delia, our officer, oh, all of you. You make me a proud teacher, a proud teacher. I'm proud of y'all. And Marty's even waving his in the back. That's incredible. So we've been looking, I said, the boring message, but really that's a play on words like a lot of our messages are, is because maps usually is as boring as a box of rocks. But looking at what we've been looking at and studying maps in accordance with Paul's life and his ministry and his journeys, we've been getting some very interesting things out of that. Now, what we've been doing is seasoning that stew or that pot of his life with the characterization of all the things that took place in Paul's life during those 30 years of ministry. Characterization in a trip will cause you to never forget the trip. Paul took three missionary journeys, and during those three missionary journeys in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, and we'll read that again tonight in just a moment, a whole bunch of stuff took place in him or to him during those three missionary journeys. They were not the typical missionary journeys that people go on today. Trips where certain things happen to you will certainly characterize that trip. I mentioned last week that a number of years ago, I think it's been four now, because Aubrey will be five this July 31st, and she was not quite one. So we took a family vacation, and we hadn't had one in years. And we had my two son-in-laws, two daughters, their only two children at the time, Candy and myself. And I had rented a van for my youngest daughter and their family. We were going to travel with us, and Mike and Amber were traveling in another vehicle. And we left here excited, happy, full of joy that we were taking a vacation to the mountains. And our first stop where we really got out and were able to enjoy the atmosphere and the food, we got robbed. Paul, in his listing of things that happened to him in his 30 years of ministry, one of those things was he got robbed. We see that he says in perils of robbers. Now, I'll never forget that trip. It was incredible. I had a habit of doing something that has now not, I've changed my habit. I used to, because I didn't want to carry a lot of stuff and Candy had her purse, I would take my wallet. We'd get out of the place and I'd give her my wallet. She'd put it in the purse. Sometimes I would give her my cell phone. If, you know, Now a lot of times I'm wearing, you know, cargo shorts. So, you know, I've got plenty of pockets, and that's fine, and I don't have that habit anymore, or it's very rare that I do. But on that particular occasion, we got out at a family restaurant up in the mountains of Georgia, and it was just so, I mean, here we were just having the best time, and we had like, you know, 8 or 9 days in front of us. We had so much stuff planned out, you know, the kids that went up there supporting themselves, they had money for their trip, but I wanted to do certain things for the kids too. And so we got out, went in the restaurant, started in. I gave my wallet to Candy, and she had it in her purse. And so our cash is in there, but we had very little cash. Most of it was going to go on, you know, whatever credit cards we have. And so we ate this family-style restaurant. If I name the name, some of you may know it. It's a beautiful place up in the upper part of Georgia, up in the mountains, just before you go into the foothills of the Smokies. And so we come out, and we were there, and Candy was tending to the kids like she often does, and we were looking at the scenery and taking pictures and stuff, and she'd remember this part better than myself, but she had put her purse in the seat of the van that we had, and there was some people right there, and I can't remember if they were taking notice of the kids or what was happening, but they were very close to us. They were very close to the van. They were on motorcycles. Sorry, Rex. not everybody that's on a motorcycle is bad. But there was two men and a lady, and we finally figured out later that when we turned our backs just for a moment, they grabbed her purse and took off. But I mean, that's the best that we can derive from the whole situation. It took us a few moments once we got down the road to realize that she didn't have her purse, but what she did not have was not only her purse, but she didn't have my wallet as well. So our personal checkbook was in there, the church checkbook was in there, although the church was not paying for our vacation. We just had it because she keeps it with her. All of our credit cards and whatever cash that we had. And so we had no identity. You're really not even supposed to be legally driving without, a driver's license. But of course I did. And we had, I remember getting out at the store once we got out to the place, because we had rented this chalet for the week. And big, nice place. And we were just so happy to be there. But there was such a damper, you know, there was such a spirit. And immediately when it happened, it was not just the human element of being robbed, but there was also, I could feel a demonic spirit that had come and engineered this whole fiasco. And so I remember getting out at the store and then go, you know, they were going to go in to buy groceries. We were going to eat out that week, but we're going to stock the cabin with groceries for the week. And we had nothing to pay. You know, we had nothing to buy. We didn't have a credit card. We didn't have a checkbook. And the other thing, too, was once you realize you're not going to get it back, it was later found by a pedestrian at a river in Cherokee, North Carolina, along the river where they tossed it out. They did not get the credit. They didn't do anything. All they got was the cash. But you can't take that chance. So what we did, we had to cancel all credit cards, checkbook, check account, put a hold on checkbooks. So the problem is that is if you have outstanding checks, then you don't want those things that are coming in to bounce. You got so many. In 24 hours, you're on the phone constantly to credit cards and to banks and all kinds of stuff. It just created I remember not having anything to contribute to them going in, and I was like beside myself. I mean, it was that devil was right here, and I wasn't cursing or anything like that. I was just really, I could feel the demonic pressure of it all, and so of course my son-in-law, he went to a place, a local bank, and I think he got $1,000 out for us or something, and that helped us through the week, and. But it was amazing. Now, the next day, I got up early, as I usually do, got up And I was walking up the mountain, went into tongues, and the Holy Spirit just went into intercession and lifted the whole thing. And the week was beautiful. One of the best vacations we ever had. But I'll never forget just that one moment in time and how that traumatized the whole week. Paul lived in a state of continual traumatization. He was constantly in that, you know, if you would have the average person that's ever been on a missions trip, well, little dear sister so-and-so or brother so-and-so, and I'm not making light of this, mission trips are good, and a lot of churches have people take, they'll take a group of young adults down to South or Central America or someplace where it's not unsafe for them. And they'll usually take them through a process of street witnessing, passing out tracts, and feeding orphans, or doing something really good, really good. And they get a little taste of the missionary life. But they'll come back and say, well, you know, the Lord touched my heart. And He did. And He touched my heart when I was down there. He touched my heart through this missionary trip. And I got a chance to feed the orphans. I got a chance to lay hands on somebody. And I saw God heal them. Or we had an altar call and people came. And we saw people that were poor. We got a chance to feed the poor. And that's all wonderful. But that wouldn't have been Paul's missionary trip. Brother Paul, can you stand up and tell us your last missionary journey? Well, yes, I can. It was very productive. I want to give God all the praise. A lot of people got saved. We were able to plant churches in these different, raise up elders, ordain elders, and spread the word. The first place we got to, before we got there, our ship went down. We were traveling on a ship. Our ship went down, and we were like a night and a day floating out there. But thank God He brought us through. After the ship went down, we got to the city that we were going to evangelize. And the very first thing is they drug us out of the city, beat us, and stoned me. But they thought I was dead, but I got raised up. Praise God, I got raised up. Praise God. And I got a reprieve for 30 days. Nobody beat me. But when I got to the next city, they beat me sorely. They beat me pretty sorely, and I hadn't been beat in a good while, and I went another 6 months, but then the Jews found me, and the first beating I'm talking about was by the Gentiles, but then the Jews found me, and they beat me. They beat me with 39 stripes. Soon thereafter, a year later, I was beaten at another city that I went to. They incarcerated me for a week and a half, and they beat my feet. The guys that were traveling with me thought for sure that I'd never walk again. But here I am, praise God. So that's my first missionary journey. So praise the Lord, isn't He? Who wants to go on the next one with me? Now, that's not exactly how it all happened, but all that bad stuff did happen to him in his life and more. And we'll read some of that again tonight. But what we have really, the reason why we're looking at this is that we're introducing to us a continual message of get tough and stay tough. Don't have to feel like that somebody has to be propping you up. Now, I'm your pastor. You have other people here that love you and shepherd over you. Homer's a tremendous assistant. We have other elders that will pray with you, stand with you, fight for you, and help you in battles. But our assistance is as you yourself are going. Be very maintenance free. Don't have to have a lot of maintenance to keep you up. Because if you're that way, you're going to be promoting other people. Get into the Word yourself. We said that Sunday. Get into the Word. If you come to me and say, Pastor, what does this scripture mean? Then I love those questions. That's really good. It lets me know, but I will make you responsible. What are you getting out of it? Because I'll ask you. Okay, you didn't just pick this out and and never read it before. Before you ask me that question, I expect you to go through it 20 or 30 times. And the whole book, usually. And then if you've got the question, come, please, send me the question or text me the question or whatever. But you've got to be in this yourself. Skin in the game. Isn't that what we had Sunday? Get your skin in the game. Invest yourself in. So very maintenance-free. The message is this. Paul is not our patron. In other words, we're not idolizing him, but we're saying, look, if he could do it, we can do it too. Why? Because we've got the same spiritual. I like that. I don't know if any of you have watched Zootopia. That's that little kid's. Oh, man, that's the funniest little thing. That little fox on there goes, we've got dinner. And the guy goes, I think it's pronounced DNA. But we've got the same dinner as Paul had. We've got the same spiritual dinner that Paul had. The chromosomes that were given to, and we looked at that last week, the two verses or the two places, we won't necessarily go there because I'm going to go through this rather quickly so I can read some other things here at the end. But 2 Timothy 1:7, Paul said to Timothy at the end of his life, this is Paul's last, he was jailed two times, the last time he's in prison in Rome, he says to Timothy, he writes to him, Timothy's in Ephesus, and he says, Timothy, God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and a sound mind. That is your human, born again, recreated in Christ, human spirit. That's who you are at conception. Then we went to another verse in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 24. And that was that we have been created in righteousness and in true holiness. So all those five different things, this is what we are. This is what you are at conception. And the reason why we say all that is to say this, going back to my pastor, one of the men that's over this congregation that I look to in great respect, Pastor Dave Roberson, is one of the things that on this walk that he taught us is if you're ever going to advance is no excuses. No excuses. Don't leave yourself room for no excuses. It doesn't mean that any of us have arrived yet. But don't give yourself an excuse as if to say, I'm this way because of that. And I can't help myself because of that. Give yourself no room for excuse. Square yourself up, your shoulders up, spiritually speaking, and say, I can do this because Jesus left me with the same. We talk about having the same spirit that Paul had or the same DNA. He got the same. Really, that DNA goes back to Jesus Christ. That's where we got it from. It's his spiritual DNA. The same spirit that raised Christ from the dead shall likewise quicken. So it is that spirit of Christ. It's the spirit of God that God quickened Christ with, and now it's termed by the word of God, the spirit of Christ. We've got that. And so our same spiritual DNA did not come. I'm not saying it came from Paul. I'm saying it came from Christ. But we as brothers and sisters in Christ have the same spiritual DNA in the sense. Now, every person has their own spiritual, your own spirit. You're still a human spirit. When the Holy Ghost created that born-again spirit, that spirit did not become deity. It's still a human spirit. You're still Ralph. I'm still Bronk. You're still Carl. It's got its own spiritual thumbprint, if you want to put it that way, but it's got the spiritual DNA of life in it that came straight from Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. So our whole deal is this. If Paul could do it, we can do it too. In his travels. Now let's look at 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, because that's where we jumped off. Because that's really, and we'll look at verse 21. We've read this each week, but that's okay. This is very important. Because what all this does is it characterizes the trips that Paul went on. It characterizes when we read where he went, and then I've given you from the Blue Letter Bible people I think it's a real good timeline of Paul's life. And wasn't that interesting last week? I thought it was really interesting, some of the things that I'm even learning more specifically about Paul's life, where he traveled, and his time frame Because when we learn something about somebody, they're not just a figure in our on black and white letters on a page. They actually become a personality to us. When we understand the age in which he was, when we understand that he was alive at the time when Christ was crucified, and he was very possibly in that area, we understand that he was a contemporary of Christ, and all these kind of things just kind of season the pot for us to understand who he was, what grace was working in his life, and the grace that can work in our life as well. Now let's look at verse 21, because this does season all of his travels. It's part of it. I speak concerning reproach, as though we had been weak. Howbeit, whereinsoever any is bold, I speak foolishly, I am bold also. Are they Hebrews? So am I. Are they Israelites? So am I. Are they seed of Abraham? So am I. Are they ministers of Christ? I speak as a fool. I am more. In laborings more abundant, in stripes above measure, in prisons more frequent, in deaths often. Of the Jews 5 times received I 40 stripes, except or save one. Thrice I was beaten with rods, once I was stoned, thrice I suffered shipwrecked, a night and a day I have been in the deep, in journeys often, in perils of waters, perils of robbers, perils of my own countrymen, and perils of heathen, and perils of city, and perils of wilderness, and perils of sea, and perils among false brethren, and weariness, painfulness, and watchings often, and hunger, and thirst, and fastings often, and cold and nakedness, beside all those things that are without, that which cometh upon me daily, the care of all the churches. Then he concludes, who is weak, and I am not weak, who is offended, and I burn not. So Paul managed to get through all these things, lived a very relatively young life, started his ministry. God started his ministry about the age 30, lived and died until about the age 61, was beheaded by the Emperor Nero in Rome after his second prison imprisonment. Now, in just a moment, we'll go through part of his missionary journey, the second missionary journey. We will recap just a little bit of what we went through last week, of where he traveled and some of the things that took place during that travel. We just read what is part of 30, what is seasoned in part of 30 years of ministry. Now the whole thing, continue to pull with me and understand what we're doing. What I want to do is transfer you from an understanding of Paul's life into a modern day understanding of your life. I want you to personalize this, because I want you to see that things as they are, we did a little before service, we did a little what you call off the record. It wasn't necessarily presented to the world, but we talked about things that are going to be happening in the next few months politically, and some things that we can expect and things that we need to watch out for. But Paul exemplifies a man after Christ. I think this is really neat, because Jesus is our prototype. But some people could argue, I'm not arguing, but some people could argue, okay, here he is, he's God-man. But he went through, and we continue to teach you this, he went through all of his temptations, he went through all of his struggles. Somehow, I don't know how it happens, but God, the God part of him, was able to stand down and live in a certain sense. This may not be the best word, this is the only word I can think of, in a dormant kind of state, not interfering with his manhood to overcome sin and to overcome the temptations, because the temptations were just as strong, and he could have caved in. He could have taken what would have happened to us? We'd have been lost. God only had one son. We're in a mess, and I don't even want to go there with what that could have, you know, transpired as a result of that. All I know is that he did not fail. Hallelujah. But some could argue is that he's the God-man. Yes, but listen, I understand that part, but I know how he lived out his life and how he won. Now we've got a man after, along with a lot of other guys that I think did just as wonderful a job as Paul, but we're studying Paul. We're isolating him. And we're looking at a man that suffered a lot of different hardships, and he had that DNA that Christ gave him, the same DNA that we have, and he was able to go through it. He was able not only to survive it, but to leave a legacy at the end of 2 Timothy. At the end of 2 Timothy, he writes to Timothy in Ephesus, and he's just a little while from being beheaded. He says, I have fought a good fight. I have kept the faith. I've not turned back. All, in essence, all those beatings, all those scourgings, all those everything that ever come against me in all of my travels, in 30 years of travel, did never turn me away from Christ. Praise God. If he could do it, we can do it. Now, you're not going on a missionary journey, most of you. You're not even being launched out into all those horrible places. We're living in, I believe, the threshold of the last days. We're living in that threshold. As I said before, I know that things are bad. We've seen a lot of bad things take place. I think things are going to get a lot worse. I think we're going to look back on these days and say, boy, these were good days. These were fun-filled days, and they were days where, by way of comparison, you really could trust being able to go out and do whatever you wanted to do without fear. There's a minimal amount of fear nowadays. Not in us. There should not be. But there is a quickening awareness to be staying in the spirit and to stay on edge. And I said, this is not a time to take. Listen, your family and yourself may depend, your life may depend on you not taking a spiritual vacation. It really does. And so stay, you know, very acute in the spirit. Keep going forward. Paul could be argued as a man that took everything that Christ gave him and showed what grace, the full grace of God, could take place or could be utilized in a person's life. A few things real quickly by way of rehearsal of last week. Jeremiah chapter 12, verse 5, we won't go there, but that was the scripture that says, look, if you can't, it said, if you can't run with the dog, stay off the porch. No, it didn't say that. If you can't run with the, it said this, and I'm paraphrasing now to skip that verse to go on. Jeremiah was complaining, and God said to Jeremiah, look, if the footmen have wearied thee, how will thou contend with the cavalry? In other words, those that are having a hard time now, and they're weary in well-doing, if the increasal of the oppression that is coming against America and the world, the oppression of sin and all the horrible things that are taking place, if present tense people don't know how to stand in peace, the Calvary is coming. And we better learn to walk in peace, and we better learn to exercise our authority over things presently in the midst of a very, very chaotic time and season. So this is what I'm transferring. This is what I desire. You're not going on missionary trips, but I want you to see the grace of God that is in this man's life and say, look, whatever comes to America, whatever comes to our front door, whatever tries to come in that door, whatever tries to come into our life, we can stand, and we can stand in strength and power, and we can stand strong, and we can see this revival no matter what administration, no matter what things come and go, we're going to stand strong. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. So get tough and stay tough. I don't know what tonight's message will be. But Terry said last week, I appreciate it. She said, boy, that illustration on Rocky, I really like that one. You remember the Rocky III movie? He thought he was something. You know, he was still built real good, cut real lean, looked real good, but he was fighting all these guys that were nothing. You know, if you go to a church, and I'm not throwing off other churches, if you go to a church where they play patty cake, and, you know, on instead of like a Sunday night service or youth adult, youth that was young adults, you know, we got an exhortation of prophecy, and it was powerful, and I got real edified. But you sit here, if you hear those edifications and those prophecies, you check yourself. And you want to walk straighter, and you want to walk stronger, and you want to keep going forward. We heard that from Kirsten, but as I said, many of you have that. I mean, many of you young ladies and young men could say the same things, that those things are working inside of you. Do you go to a church where the get-togethers are all based around fellowship? And I'm not against fellowship. I don't think we have enough of them. Pizza parties. And a few short verses of, like, we're going to read a word, or we're going to sit, let's sit in a circle, and I'm going to read a scripture, a verse to you, and then we're going to go around the circle, and we're going to ask everybody, what do you think? What's your take on? You have opened something up. See, what we're teaching on Sunday about radical grace, the reason why that has been able to be propagated is that a lot of times, and let me be nice here. we've got a lot of young aspiring, and some, many times they're just, they love God, but they have no fathers. There's no fathers. They have no fathers teaching them. And they have no fathers disciplining them with the love of God. And they have young men and young ladies coming in, what's that song that black guy sang? It's a slant against the thugs in a certain sense. Pants on the ground, pants on, what was that? You know, hat turned sideways, pants on the ground. And the only reason, and I'm not against that either. I'm not saying anything. I'm just saying there's a irresponsible, young kind of with no fatherhood, not teaching them the responsibility of contextually going in and speak. Now you guys are being taught this, and many other people are being taught this, and young people are being, young adults are being taught this. So when they speak, they may not always get it perfect, but they're speaking with a rationalization of a necessity to know what is the word saying. What is the contextual saying? What's the relevance of what the chapters before and the chapters are after? And a lot of what is happening with the fallacies of the hyper-grace message is there's been no fathers to teach, and there's been no fathers to instill into them the necessity of a contextual revelation. And so people, they'll just, young guns, a lot of times they'll just pick out a verse and they'll say, let's discuss it. Let's discuss, with having no idea of what was before it or after it. And if you get 10 or 15, 20-year-olds or 25-year-olds, and they've never really read, and they may love the word. They may know somebody told them it was God's word, and they said, okay. But you just give them a verse, and then everybody's going to sit around and just talk about that verse. My God. You want to hear idiocy to the nth, eighth? Yeah, I don't know how many powers you got. Well, I think it's. There's only one revelator. His name is the Holy Ghost. And so you know what all that is? A lot of it's not their fault. A lot of it's they never had fathers. They never had, I'm not talking about physical fathers. They didn't have fathers of the faith that loved them enough to teach them how you get truth out of that word. It's all truth, but you've got to get truth out of it. Hallelujah. So we digress there for a moment, but that's good. That's where we're at. That's where we're headed. Hallelujah. Oh my. Help me, Jesus. Let's look at Paul's travels for just a moment. Wasn't it interesting? I said that before. Last week we looked at his life a little bit. Jesus, We said we weren't going to explain this, but Jesus was actually born in 4 to 6 B.C. Okay, you say, well, I think in B.C. before Christ. Actually, it doesn't quite work that way. But Paul was born about 5 A.D. So Jesus was about 9, 10 years old when Paul was born. As we looked last week and we went through a whole bunch of different things that were part of Paul's life, and I'll just mention a few as I go down through here. He at the age of 10, through 15 years of age, that was 15 to 20 A.D., he was at the school of Gamaliel in Jerusalem, and that's in Acts 22:3. At the crucifixion of Christ, Paul was about 25 years old, and the crucifixion of Christ took place in 30 A.D., so Jesus being about 33, 34 years old. Paul, I don't have any scripture that I can give you. I can only surmise that Paul absolutely, if he never met Jesus or if he never saw him, he absolutely had to have heard of him. He absolutely had to have heard of the fame of Jesus. Israel's not a big place, very, very small. Jesus traveled through all of Israel. So when you got somebody that's only 8 to 10 years older, Paul's a young man. He was 25 years old when Christ was crucified. He was 27 years old, Acts 7, 58 through Acts 8, 1. He was approximately 27 years old when he stood there, held the garments for the people that stoned Stephen. He was a young, aspiring Pharisee, hoping to work himself up into the government position in the Pharisees and stand or sit on the board of the Sanhedrin, very possibly. At his conversion, he was 29 to 30. In Acts 9, 1 through 9, he goes to Damascus. And we've got scripture on all this, not just historical documentation, but in Galatians 1, 17, we read where he travels to Arabia and remains there after his salvation. Paul is travels on. He's 31 to 32. He's returns to Damascus about 37 A.D., then exits the city for safety, and I gave scriptures on that last week. I gave scriptures on this, Acts 9, 26 through 29, and Galatians 1, 18. He goes up to Jerusalem after 3 years, having never met Peter, James, John. He goes back to Tarsus, and for about 7 or 8 years, we have no idea historically or biblically what he was doing. At least I don't. I don't have it in front of me. And then we find in Acts 11, 25 that Barnabas must have, of course, hears about Saul. At that time, his name was Saul, travels to Tarsus in order to seek for Saul. He goes to Antioch with Barnabas and teaches many people. Agabus prophesies in Acts 11, 27 about a famine that takes place. That's all in 47 A.D. This is all in that 1 year. Aid is sent to Jerusalem through Barnabas and Saul, Acts 11. I'm just going to give the actual chapters to save time. Barnabas and Saul return with John Mark. That's a nephew. That's in Acts 12. Barnabas and Saul are separated and sent out, and that's in Acts 13. Paul's very young, still 42 years old, when he's separated for the gospel. That's when his first missionary journey actually started, right after that. They travel to Antioch, Cilicia, and then to Cyprus, and that's in Acts 13. While at Cyprus, they go to Salamis, and Paphos, that's Acts 13, 5 through 12. Excuse me on some of these pronunciations are kind of new to me. Paphos, from there they go to Paphos, they go to Perga, Pamphylia, where John Mark departs, and that's in Acts 13, 13. This is all on this is his first missionary journey. We went over this last week. We're skipping ahead. We'll get into the second one here in a moment. He ministers at Antioch of Pisidia. Told you there's two Antiochs in the book of Acts. That's in Acts 13, 14 through 50. At Iconium, in Acts, then he goes to Iconium. Now, on that map, you can trace all this. And you see where he goes into Asia, which is Turkey. We studied a lot of Turkey. He's in Syria. He's in a lot of these places that now are getting public review on the news. He was there. At Iconium, he goes in Acts 13. He flees to Lystra and Derbe, preaches the gospel in Acts 14. In Lystra, Paul and Barnabas are mistaken for gods because they heal a crippled man. That was pretty neat. And then it turns right around with it just in days. People come down from Antioch that stirred the people up. And, you know, they're saying, "You're a god, you're a god. Oh, no, 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 we're going to kill you." Then it turned right around within days. The same city of Lystra where they tried to give him an homage that he did not receive. They turn right around because people come in. See, this was the whole thing of Paul's life. There was a spirit. 2 Corinthians 11 goes in, of course, to 2 Corinthians chapter 12. It's all one writing. And Paul identifies that all of that, this trouble, this cloud of chaos, has been engineered by a thorn in the flesh, a messenger of Satan. Now, theologians for years have debated what that was. And thank God for Pastor Dave and the Holy Ghost. If you meditate, those things are so easy. I mean, you just contextually, you just keep reading and you read and you say, okay, wait, he's having all this trouble in chapter 11, which there's no chapter 11, chapter 12. He's having all these imprisonments, these stonings. And then in chapter 12, he says, I know there was this messenger of Satan that was sent to buffet me. He's sent to buffet me. And you understand by the correlation that obviously, what was this messenger? It was this continual messenger that wherever Paul went, he stirred up the people. He stirred up a vehemence, a hatred, and something that just wanted to kill this man. And Paul was continually in the presence of terrorists. He was continually in the presence of people that wanted to kill him. And yet, Paul did not, he was not killed by a terrorist. He was not killed. He finally gave his life willingly as a martyr. And listen, if we walk in this grace, not by presumption, we will never be taken out until it is our time to give up our life for Christ. We will not, thank you. Thank you for those amen. We will not prematurely go to the grave before it is our time and we voluntarily say, it is Christ in me. I'm ready to go. Okay, hallelujah. And that's a good thing to know. Amen. That's a good thing to know because we get to choose. He was stoned at Lystra by those that came down, stirred up the people. This spirit, this demonic spirit, it sounds like God wouldn't take it from him, but he did in a certain sense because he said, my grace is sufficient. maybe this Sunday, I'm not sure if it's this Sunday or next, we'll get into the two meanings of the word grace. Grace is, we'll break down the word grace because we've been studying hypergrace. But the word grace in the Greek breaks down with two capacities. What the church has always done is accentuated the one side, but grace is a two-sided thing even in the Greek. And Paul actually preached the grace on the side that compared the meaning of strength. That grace was strength given over to weakness. That's what grace was to the New Testament Christian. It was the strength to overcome sin. It wasn't grace to give permission to sin. They take the one side of grace, which is one part of the meaning of grace, which is unmerited favor, and then they misconstrue that into other areas and say, okay, this grace, this part of the meaning of grace, amplifies over into my ability to be able to sin and do whatever I want to do, and God's still okay with it. Really, the graduation of grace past the threshold of salvation is God's imparted strength for your weakness to live above sin and to go forward and to be perfected in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. So Paul was stoned at Lystra. And the amazing part is what? He did what when he got stoned? Did he leave? Somebody help me. No, Homer's shaking his head. He went right back into the city. Then the next day they left, okay? So I think maybe his head was still messed up a little bit. So concussion. He had a bad concussion. These guys played football. They went to D1 schools. They played football a lot more than I did. But I had some boys hit me in high school and with helmet to helmet. And it's like when you get those things and all those stars are just all in front of your face and you're looking around, you're like, you can be walking that way and that's not even your sideline. No, come on, bring him back over here. Bring back. Paul must have had a concussion. Is it that way, Carl? Yes, it is. So he departs with Barnabas to Derbe, preaching the gospel. Then they returned, that's Acts 14. They returned to Lystra, Iconium, and Antioch to strengthen the disciples and appoint elders in Acts 14, that's 21 through 24. From Poseidon, they returned to Antioch of Syria. You're not catching all this, but you're understanding it and appreciating it, I'm sure. Of all of where he traveled, remember the mixture. Remember the seasoning. We don't even have it all here scripturally. We've got 2 Corinthians 11 that said it happened. We just don't know exactly in which all these cities it did happen. We've got a few times, like at Lystra, we know he said he was once stoned. Okay, we know where that one stoning was at. That was at Lystra. Then he goes up after that's the end. That particular journey ends in about 48 AD. Then he goes up to Jerusalem Council with Barnabas, and that's in Acts 15, 1 through 29, and also a comparative verses in Galatians 2 and 1. Paul and Barnabas return to Antioch of Syria, teaching and preaching, and that's in Acts 15, 30 through 35, and Galatians 2. 11 through 14. They return, and they haven't yet started on their second journey. During that time, during that year, I guess while they're contending on where they're going to go, a contention over John Mark, Barnabas, and Paul have a problem about taking John Mark, and there's a contention over John Mark, and Barnabas and John Mark sail to Cyprus, and that's in Acts 15. Then, at the end of that year, at the year of 49, Paul and Silas depart, because Paul takes Silas with him, and that's in Acts 15, 40 through 41. Paul and Silas depart and go through Syria. Paul is about 44 years old when he starts his second missionary journey. Now, this one lasts for a while. This lasts from 49 AD through part of 52 AD, maybe even past that. This is where he went. Paul and Silas depart and go through Syria and Sicilia, strengthening the churches, and that's Acts 15, 40 through 41. Then somewhere in the beginning of the year 50 AD, Paul's 45, they go to Derbe, Lystra. They're going right back. I said this last week. They make this big circle. They go right back into these places where persecution at one time has basically killed him, but he has no quitting sense. He's just determined to follow the Spirit of the Lord. And he picks up, when they go to Derbe and Lystra, and they pick up Timothy, strengthening the churches, and then that's Acts 6. 1 through 5. They go to Troas, and Paul sees a vision of a Macedonian man in Acts 16, 6 through 10. This is all part of that second journey, and this is towards the end of 50 AD. Towards the beginning of 51 AD, they sail to Troas and Neapolis, and that's in Acts 16, 11. And then they go to Philippi, where Paul meets Lydia. That's in Acts 16, 12 through 15. Now, remember Lydia? Lydia's from Thyatira. That's one of the cities of the book of Acts. And Thyatira, if you'll remember, that's the place where they had all of these precious commodities. And she was a seller of purple. And they had these guilds there. Remember the guilds? They were these business co-ops, if you want to say it that way, and Lydia was part of that, and she probably was a very rich lady. Paul and Silas in 51, right after they meet Lydia, or in Acts 16, in the same chapter, 16 through 25, Paul and Silas are imprisoned after casting out a demon from a slave girl. Prison doors open miraculously, and that's in Acts 16, 25 through 34. If you've never, ever heard Gary Carpenter's rendition on Paul's vision that led him to Macedonia, and then the trouble they get in, Paul and Silas imprisoned, and that whole thing, Gary does an absolutely incredible job talking about, he has a tremendous revelation there concerning once the prison doors were opened, why they did not leave, and that all boils down to the man that Paul saw in the vision. Now I'm really jumping ahead here, and I'm summarizing real quick because it's a really strong revelation, a good revelation, that the man that he saw in the vision had to have been the Philippian jailer. That's why he did not flee. And but the comical part is that that during that time of incarceration, however long that was, that night, that Paul had told Silas, "We're going over there based on a vision," and Gary says it so comically, while they were in stocks. And he says, "I envision these English stocks where people have their heads out and their hands like this. Have you ever seen those before? You know, the old Robin Hood days where they..." And he said, "I can see Silas looking over at Paul and saying, 'You had a vision, did you? You got us here by a vision, did you?'" So it's really, but he does an incredible good job on it. I love to hear him say it or tell it every time. But that's in Acts 16, and this is all part of that second missionary journey. So we get some biblical chronology along with 2 Corinthians 11, where he says all this stuff happened to him. He was in prison there, and they were beaten there. That's one of the times that he was beaten. They depart from Philippi in Acts 16, and they pass through Amphipolis and Apollonia, and that's Acts 17. And then they go to Thessalonica and preach Christ, but then they had to flee. They had to leave. They go to Berea, where he leaves Silas and Timothy, and that's Acts 17, 10 through 14. And at Corinth, they go to Corinth and are rejoined with Silas and Timothy, and that's Acts 18, 1 through 17. Paul returns to Antioch after stopping at Ephesus, Caesarea, and Jerusalem. Now at 53, somewhere in the beginning part of 53, that is kind of the end. Paul will start another missionary journey at somewhere around the age of 48. And we'll go into some of that next week. But let me just, we probably won't have time to go into all of it. But by way of comparison, just by way of trying to, as I said before, transfer over to you our objective. Our objective is what? Our objective is this. Look at Paul's life and travels. Look at all the mess that he got into, and yet he died victoriously. He did not die before his time. He died with a smile on his face, and he died having gone through all of that because of what he was made of, and then to know what we're made of, knowing that we probably won't have the same assignment of the missionary journeys, but this is the world. I'm holding up a representation of the world that we live in today. This is not for scare tactics. It's just for a realization of we're not going on missionary journeys, but chaos is around us continually. Chaos is around us continually. And I think sometimes that we forget, I forget, of the horrendous things that have taken place in the last 20 years or 30 years. And I have somewhat of a list. I don't have everything. But I think just to let us know the day and hour that we live in, I want to bring to our attention and to read just a little bit and just kind of footnote some of the horrible, horrific, mad insanity shootings and killings that have taken place, not in the world, but in America, in the last 20 to 30 years. Now, this escalation has taken place just in modern history. It's just because we're going into that, I like to use that word, vortex. We're being pulled into something. We absolutely are being pulled into the last day. Well, the latest one, America-wise, happened in right here, a few hours away from us. The United States suffered the worst mass shooting in its modern history when 50 people were killed and 53 injured in Orlando, Florida, after a gunman stormed and packed the packed gay nightclub. The gunman was killed by a SWAT team after taking hostages at Pulse, a popular gay bar. He was preliminary identified as the 29-year-old Omar Mateen. Then in December of last year, December 2nd, and as I said, you'll remember these, but then you'll think, oh, wow, maybe forgot some of these. December 2nd of 2015, which is not so long ago, 14 dead, 22 wounded in San Bernardino, California. The two assailants killed 14, wounded 22 more in a shooting in the Inland Regional Center in San Bernardino. The two attackers were married and were killed in the gun battle with police. These were U.S.-born Saeed, I'm not going to try to go into all their names, take the time, because we got to move on. They were found with an arsenal of ammunition, pipe bombs, and Redland home, at their Redland home. November, just the month before, November 29, 2015, three dead and nine injured in Colorado Springs, Colorado. A gunman entered a Planned Parenthood clinic. Now, not all these are terrorists, but it's just letting you know terrorists as from a Islamic or Muslim group or whatever. But these are people that are going insane in these last days, and this is the world that we live in. A gunman entered a Planned Parenthood clinic in Colorado Springs and started firing police named Robert Lewis Deere as the suspect. In the attacks, three people were killed. The university police officer, Garrett, names this, and the different ones. October, okay, so we went from November. Then October 1st, the month before, 2015, nine dead and nine injured in Roseburg, Oregon. Christopher Sane Harper Mercer shot and killed eight fellow students and a teacher at this community college. Authorities described Harper Mercer, who recently had moved to Oregon from Southern California, as a hate-filled individual with anti-religious and white supremacist learnings, who had long struggled with a mental illness. He owned 14 weapons, all purchased legally. Mercer, 26, killed himself after exchanging gunfire. July of that summer of last year, 2015, five dead and three wounded in Chattanooga, Tennessee. A gunman opened fire on two military centers more than 7 miles apart on a Thursday, killing four Marines and a Navy sailor. A man identified as a federal authorities, a Muhammad, it's harder to pronounce his name, 24, sprayed dozens of bullets at a military recruiting center, then drove to a Navy Marine training facility, opened fire again before he was killed. So July, and then in June the 18th, nine were killed in Charleston, South Carolina, as Dylan Storm Roof is charged with nine accounts of murder and three accounts of attempted murder in an attack that killed nine people on a historical black church in Charleston, South Carolina. Authorities say Roof, as a suspected white supremacist, started firing on a group gathered in Emmanuel African Methodist Episcopal Church after first praying with them. Then it fled authorities before he was arrested in North Carolina. See, there's nothing. There's churches, schools, bars. Doesn't matter. Six dead, seven wounded in Isla Vista, California. Elliot Rogers, 22. This was May. Okay, so we're in May, the month before. Elliot Rogers, 22, meticulously planned his deadly attack on Isla Vista community for more than a year, spending thousands of dollars in order to arm and train himself to kill as many people as possible. According to a report raised at Santa Barbara Sheriff, County Sheriff's Office, Roger killed six people before shooting himself. April, just the month before. No, we're now in 2014. Excuse me. That was May of 2014. This is April of 2014. Three killed, 16 injured in Fort Hood, Texas. A gunman at Fort Hood, the scene of the deadly 2009 rampage, kills three people and injured 16 others, according to the military officials. The gunman is dead at the scene. 12, and this September of 16, remember we're going back, 16 of 2013, 12 killed, three injured in Washington, D.C., is Aaron Alexis, a naval contractor and former naval enlisted man, shoots and kills 12 people, engaged police in a running firefight through sprawling Washington Naval Yard. He is shot and killed by authorities. Authorities later revealed that he had an extensive naval disciplinary record that included several unauthorized absences from duty, insubordination, disorderly conduct, and on and on to go. Five killed at Santa Monica, and that's June 7th, 2013. John Zawari, excuse me if that's wrong, an unemployed 23-year-old kills five people in an attack that starts at his father's home and ends in Santa Monica College, where he is fatally shot by police at a school's library. 27 killed. This is December 14th, 2012. 27 killed and one injured at Newtown, Connecticut. A gunman forces his way into Sandy Hook Elementary School in Newton, Connecticut, and shoots and kills 20 first graders and six adults. The shooter, Adam Lanza, 20, kills himself at the scene. Lanza also kills his mother at the home they shared prior to the shooting rampage. And emotional remarks from the, okay, so we've got some remarks from our president, and which I pray for all the time. October 21st, 2012, three dead and four injured at Brooksville, Wisconsin. Radcliffe Houston, a 45-year-old former Marine, walks into an Azana salon and spa where his estranged wife works and shoots and kills her and two other women, wounding four others. And witnesses say that Honston's wife, Zena, calmly tried to protect co-workers and customers before she was killed. She had recently sought restraining orders and on and on. September 28, 2012, six killed and two injured in Minneapolis, Minnesota. As a result, Andrew Delinger, 36, breaks into a sign company offices and opens fire, killing the owner and five others before turning the gun on himself. Endelinger had been fired from a Accent Systems, a small company. August 5, 2012, six killed, three injured in Oak Creek, Wisconsin. Wade Michael Page fatally shoots six people at a Sikh temple before he was shot by police. I'm not going to give all the details, so I'm going to go on here. 12 killed, July 20th, 2012, 12 killed and 58 injured in Aurora, Colorado. James Holmes, 24, is taken into custody in the parking lot outside the Century 16 movie theater after a post-midnight attack at Aurora, Colorado. Holmes allegedly entered the theater through an exit door about half an hour into the local premiere, The Dark Knight Rises. He faces charges of killing 12 people and injuring 58. Seven killed and three injured in Oakland. This is probably not the way it's pronounced. It's spelt like one, but I don't know if one L. Go, 43, a former student of Oikos University A small Christian college allegedly opens fire in the middle of the classroom, leaving 7 people dead and 3 wounded. Goh was charged with 7 accounts of murder in special circumstances and 3 accounts of attempted murder. In October 12 of 2011, 8 were killed and 1 injured in Seal Beach, California. Scott Dekra, 41, apparently enraged over a custody dispute, allegedly walks into a crowded Seal Beach hair salon where his former wife worked. Now, this is another one, and opens fire. 8 people were killed, including a man sitting in a truck outside of the salon. On January 8th of 2011, 6 were killed and 11 injured in Tucson, Arizona. Are you getting the gist? I mean, I know we hear this, and we've heard it as the years have gone by, but this is not all. But it's happening. This is the world we're living in. Jared Lee Logner, 22, allegedly shoots an Arizona Republican, Gabriel Gifford, in the head during a meeting and meet and greet. In August 3, 2010, 8 were killed and 2 injured in Manchester, Connecticut. Omar S. Thornton, 34, driver of a Hartford distributors, emerges from a disciplinary hearing, begins shooting, killing 8 people at the family-owned distributorship, and then himself. In February 12, 2010, 3 killed and 3 wounded in Huntsville, Alabama. Amy Bishop, 45, neurobiologist and assistant professor at the university. See, these are intelligent people. Some of them are doctors at the University of Alabama in Huntsville, shoots and kills 3 people at a biological facility. In November 5, 2009, 13 killed and 32 injured in Fort Hood, Texas. This is the second Fort Hood shooting. This man, Hansen, an Army psychiatrist, allegedly shoots and kills 13 people. April 3rd, 2009, 13 killed, 4 injured in Brigantine, New York. Vond, 41, shoots and kills 13 people, seriously wounds 4 others. February 14, 2008, 5 killed, 16 injured in this city in Illinois. Goes on. December 5th, 8 killed and 4 injured in Omaha. Robert Hawkins, 19, sprays in Omaha shopping mall with gunfire on a holiday. April 6, 2007, 32 killed and 17 injured in Blacksburg, Virginia. Sehud Cho, a 23-year-old Virginia Tech senior, opens fire on a campus, killing 32 people in a dorm and an academic building in attacks more than 2 hours apart. February the 12th, 2007, 5 were killed and 4 injured in Salt Lake City. I won't even go into all this. October 2, 2006, 5 killed and 5 injured in Nickel Mines, PA. And gives the faces, 6 dead. Goleta, California, how'd that come about? Jennifer San Marco, a former U.S. Postal Service employee, shot and killed 6 people at a mail processing plant March 21st, 2005. 9 killed, 7 injured at Red Lake, Indiana Reservation, Minnesota. July 8th, I'm just skipping some of this. July 8, 2003, 5 killed, 9 injured in Meridian, Mississippi. Doug Williams, 48, production assembly for 19 years at Lockheed Martin Aeronautics Company, goes on a rampage at the defense plants and fatally shoots 5. 3 killed in Tucson, 2 killed, that was on October 28th, 2 killed and 13 injured in Santee, California by, see this, I get it, I know I'm going over tonight, you'll love me, this young man, handsome, yeah, probably at one time, goes on a shooting rampage. This guy here, December 26th, 7 killed in Wake Forest, Massachusetts. 7 November 2nd, 1999, 7 killed in Honolulu. By this guy, September 15th, 1997, 1999, 7 killed, 7 injured at Fort Worth. July 29th, okay, we've gone over that. These guys are probably the most famous. April 20th, 1999, 13 killed and 24 injured in Columbine, Colorado. These are handsome, I don't know, they're probably juniors. Eric Harris and Dylan Kalibode, students at the Columbine High, opened fire at the school, killing a dozen students and teachers, causing injury to two dozen others before taking their own lives. They look normal, but folks, this is the end time. This is the worst for me. These two little guys here, middle school students, Michael Johnson and Andrew Golden, pull a fire alarm at their school. This is March 24, 1998. They pull a fire alarm at their school in a small rural Arkansas community and open fire on students and teachers using an arsenal they had stashed in the nearby woods. Four students and teachers who tried to shield the children are killed. 10 others are injured because of their ages. Mitchell, 13. This guy's 13. This guy's 11. What makes a 13? When I was 11 years old, I was still a baby. I just thought like a little, what? It's the world. These little guys, and I mean, they just look like your little kids. 13 and 11 goes in and starts just killing people, just killing people, just killing. Now and I'll tell you how they were raised. I wasn't in their home. They were raised without God. Okay. And then they probably were allowed to get into all kinds of dungeons and dragons and all kinds of that stuff. Now listen, I've shot animals and I eat the game that I shoot, okay? But there's something real dangerous, something incredibly dangerous about these games that they have nowadays where people are shooting other human beings. It so desensitizes. So desensitized. Now the graphics are so graphic that it looks like another human being. And when you take a gun and you shoot another human being time and time and time again, and you say, well, they're the enemy, it so desensitizes. This 13-year-old, this 11-year-old, they had done this several times on games. They'd done it so many times that it was almost like just walking into another. That stuff is so demonic. It gets in the head of these young people. It destroys their sensitivity. Absolutely destroys their sensitivity. I go on and on and on and on and on and on. I don't have time. You got to go home. Folks, it's time. Get strong and stay strong. It's the last days. There's going to be a lot more shootings. This is not the end. There's going to be a lot more killings. There's going to be a lot more desperate situations. God needs a group of people like you to stay strong and show the way ahead. Amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you for being patient. Stand with me.